everybody. Welcome to BK Live. I'm Brian Vines.
And I'm Melody Vargas. Good Thursday to you.
Thank you. I woke up and just felt like today was a little off. Do you remember one of those where it was like one of those peewee things where you want to pull the cover back over? But I got here and Jonathan Leaf bought bagels in, and I knew the day was due for a turnaround.
I saw no bagels.
Oops. That's because I got to him first.
Well,
I left the home with no breakfast, no nothing. I just like got out this morning. I was like, it's Thursday like this. And then there were bagels and I smiled and it's been great since then.
Well, I'm glad it worked out for you, B.
Thank you.
I hope I get a bagel afterwards.
Well, the Pope is coming.
That's true.
That's
true.
There's always hope.
Yeah. You know what you can do now?
Huh.
Make Pope toast.
How would you make Pope toast?
With a Pope toaster. There's a toaster you can get. You put your little toast in, and it comes out.
With the image of
a
the Pope
tart.
And it's a miracle.
It's a miracle every day.
It's like
breakfast.
The Obama chia head. Is that kind of sacrilegious?
Is there an
to
Obama
have?
Chia head?
Oh, yeah. Years ago, when there was
There's
Obama
been,
fried
been
chicken,
one.
Obama chia head, Obama everything. But I heard in their conversation when they met prior to this meeting that President Obama talked to the Pope about celebritydom since he was getting all this buzz about being so progressive and people were adopting all of his thoughts and teachings that, like, to guard against getting a big head kind of thing because you're the rockin'est Pope ever, apparently.
All right. That's nice advice.
Yeah, it's a
That's
high
good
level
advice.
Talk. High level
yeah,
talk.
And I don't think he's been susceptible to that. I think he's doing all right.
Still pushing that fiat.
He really is. So we're actually T-minus 5 hours from Pope Francis touching down at New York's JFK Airport. And to say papal fever is reaching epidemic proportions would be an understatement. Although the pontiff won't be setting foot in Brooklyn, we're still going to be discussing the potential impact of his historic visit, both in the now and the long term, with the street nun, Sister Ana Martinez de Luco.
And in these last few hours of calm, we're also going to get a view of the open seas via Red Hook's Valentino Pier, as seen from the radio-controlled 3D printed boats angling for the lead at the 2015 Red Hook Regatta. Then from the high seas to the high comedy that is our favorite duo, Dick and Dave. They are joining us this week as Dick, Dave, and a drink from the fine folks at Drink Lounge in Crown Heights.
Mm-hmm. But before that drink, we're going to stop by Bed-Stuy, where a flash exhibit promises to highlight the stories of that neighborhood with a pair of modern-day griots, joining us to detail the synthesis of photos and film. But first up, some present-day events of historic proportions when we discuss Pope Francis in New York City.
Maybe this, maybe that will fall apart in each other's arms. Alternate universe will be knocking, knocking on our wall and here
everything about the 266th Pope. 266th even, yeah. Seems to be newsworthy. What can we tell you about the 78-year-old Argentinian that hasn't already been said? Mm-hmm. From his stance on climate change, homosexuality, annulments, and ditching the pomp, circumstance, and red Prada slippers, mm-hmm. to the common touch with his worldwide congregation and a Twitter account, we seem to know it all.
Pope Francis has been called a pontiff for these times. Who better to help us discuss a modern pope than a nun who seems to be cut from the same cloth? Sister Ana Martinez de Luco earned the moniker the street nun from her time doing good in the hood, not clutching a rosary, but turning cans into cash for hardworking Brooklynites in need. At Sure We Can, a bottle and can redemption center in East Williamsburg. Sister Ana, welcome back to BK Live.
Hello.
Hello.
It's my second time to be here.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. So for those who didn't see you the first time, tell us what that means, Brooklyn's street nun. Where did that come from?
Well, it was just an anecdote, I think. I was having friends in Penn Station, women who used to live literally in Penn Station. So one of the days I approached them, two of them, Virginia and Rose. And Virginia was long-time acquaintance with me, so she knew that I was a nun, this. And it seems she was sharing that with Rose, an elderly in their 80s, most probably. Yeah. So Rose looked at me when I arrived, and she said, "That you are a nun?" I said, yeah, kind of. "What kind of nun are you?" I said, a street nun. And it sounds nice for me.
And it stuck.
So, yeah, no more questions. So.
Why was it so unbelievable? Because you don't wear?
Because I was living with them and sharing with them, and suddenly the other is telling that I am a nun, so it did not fit
her
parameters of being a nun.
So. Yeah, it's not the image that we usually have.
Well, we got to run in with microphone, you're fine. Uh-huh. So there's like those ideas that folks have about what a nun should be, and people have some very strong ideas as well about what a pope should be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So how do you think that our guy Francis is sort of turning that on its head?
Yeah. A few months ago they asked me the same question more or less, and I said, why the pope is so popular? I said, just because he's just normal. I mean, it's a normal pastor trying to be Jesus Christ on the earth. And because he's so normal, what a pastor, a good pastor should be, it seems it calls the attention to everybody around. Mm. So I think it's just he's being himself, following the spirit of Jesus, which makes him so popular. Mm-hmm. I mean, we were so used to other kind of
like
figures.
Over there, like untouchable.
Yeah, and much more. Like power, Vatican,
power, opulence.
Yeah, it kind of. So this time, it's just Francis, the brother Francis. He loves to be called like that, as simple as that.
Can I ask a question, though? We were watching when he got off the plane, when he touched down here, and he got into his modest car and was driving around instead of the huge SUV and all that. And I was just thinking to myself, how much of that disseminates to the rest of the flock and the leaders? Like, is having a pope who keeps it so ground level transferring to the everyday folks? Or is everyone, all the other guys, still living more opulently? Or just the whole, like, office culture now that the boss is different?
Yeah. I guess I'm not so sure how it is, but my impression is that those who were there in their administrative work and title, figures like that, I think they remain there.
Yeah.
They may not be very comfortable with this figure of Francis saying that is not our style, but I think those won't change much because if they are like that, it's because they are like that, period.
Yeah.
What Francis have, for me, the effect is that the masses, which were far already from this hierarchical style, which it was not very attached or not very close to the masses and to the interest of the people. Mm-hmm. So he was able to say, "Oh no, I am here, and this is our church, the church of the poor, the church of of compassion, the church of welcoming, of inclusion. This is we. So the fact that the main representative, so to say, of the church says that and lives out of that, millions and millions feel like, oh yeah, we are that, because we felt like we were so far already.
Right.
And in fact, this is what we feel, it was the correct way of feeling and being church. No?
So. And does it have an impact for you on the street? I mean, being then on the ground, being the people in the work that you do, do you feel that message now more from the churches around you and the neighborhood and the community?
I will just tell an anecdote. Mm-hmm. The co-founder of Sure We Can, Eugene Gaston, is a man who had been most of his life on the streets, mm-hmm. a canner, homeless, whatever. And he is not also Catholic. I mean, he grew up in the Baptist denomination. But the first time that Pope came out through that balcony to greet the people when he became a Pope, and the first thing that he said, please pray for me. He was so touched. He said, wow, he says the same that I say. I need people to pray for me. And the Pope says exactly the same. So he feels so close to him. And so in these days, he was so enthusiastic. Anna, on the 25th, don't count with me. I will be the whole day on Manhattan. No one of us had tickets.
Right.
So I will be in some corner somewhere. I have to see the Pope like a child with Santa Claus wars. He was really... So yesterday, a friend of us came with a ticket that somebody gave, a special ticket for her. She's an Argentinian, Rita. Mm-hmm. So she was offering to me as a very special gift. Yeah. Anna, I have a ticket for you, please, please. I said, you know, if there is a ticket, the one who has to go is Eugene, because he's dying to see the Pope.
Oh,
so this morning, I mean, he had the ticket, and tomorrow he's, this morning also he was planning at what time he has to leave, this and this. And I mean, and he said, I never had been interested for any Pope in the church,
like the
and now.
Even the Catholic.
Yes.
And now I am so enthusiastic about this man who seems to be so close to me and so close to the people. So. And that is just one example, no? But I can see that he had impregnated the people in the ground so nicely and so simple. Yeah. I mean,
did he take the ticket? Did he go?
Oh yeah, he's going tomorrow.
He's going.
To
okay.
The Central Park.
It's on Craigslist right
wow,
now.
At what time? He's crazy
that's
going.
Amazing.
Yes.
So, sister, the last time you were here, we were talking about the canners and the Redemption Center, and you guys were up against the sort of brick wall about whether you were going to stay in the space. Uh-huh. Update us as to what's happening now, while everybody has all this goodwill and they're reaching in their pockets for $3,000 tickets to stand on a lawn.
Yeah. So, we are in the same situation. The owner believes that we could find a way to secure the lot, and because they believe, we believe, mm-hmm. and the money is not there.
Yeah.
But there are a lot of people who came, how can we do a capital campaign? How can we do this? How mm-hmm. can we develop the social media? So we are encouraged and helped by so many ideas and so many goodwill people, and with the great hope that somewhere, somehow, it will be a community land trust who acquired the land for the good of the community. Mm-hmm. I mean, there is no need really that Sure We Can owns the land, but that it could continue serve the community and use for the community.
Do you get any funding from the church for the organization?
We did not ever get. But this year, because there was an article in New York Times last June.
And you were on BK Live.
Right, and maybe so, with the new Pope?
Yeah, and so Monsignor
Francis.
Monsignor Sullivan, who is in charge of the Catholic Charities, invited me for a radio show. So he knew about us, he promised to visit us. And we hope that the church will contribute something,
Come on, Frankie, baby, here in town, give us some money.
Because he's so outspoken about the way the church has been organized in the past, do you feel like that gives you on the ground more of a voice to speak up and kind of be heard by the church here?
At least you get a different position, I will say, no? Like, when you feel like people will look at you as you are wrong and this and this, so you keep silence. You don't think it is true, but at least you have to keep silent. But when you have a Pope that back you so much, and as you said, you empathize with him so much from the heart, so you feel like, I mean, you have the right to talk and the right to tell your brother and sister in the church that, well, he's reminding us that we have to, I mean, like just declaring the next year is the year of mercy. And all these things are so meaningful for me. No? Yeah. Like, we are just like that, mercy, compassion, acceptance, openness, and walking together. And that is so refreshing and so, I mean, so life-giving, as simple, yes.
So looking at this year of mercy you're already excited about, what do you think the lasting impact or legacy of this papal visit is going to mean in Brooklyn and New York and for people here who got to witness and touch the Pope?
Yeah. I guess the media are already saying that many people who felt already like,
disconnected,
we cannot be of that church, and it's too much, and it's too much. They regain interest, and she said, oh, yeah, this is our church, and we like to be part of it. I mean, that kind of new belongingness or new recovery that it's good to be a Catholic. I mean, it's nothing shameful to be a Catholic, no? That is one of the things that I think we have already recovered, in that sense that also the Pope is attractive for people who are not Catholic. And there are so many people who value him in politics, in many other spheres. And the third thing is that, as I said, we won't be quarreling. I mean, we tend to put, especially politics, but like in this issue about abortion, about homosexuality, about this, about that, as if we are backed by the whole church, that this should not be issued. But a lot of other issues we don't care, which are very essential to our life, but we don't care. So we take like the church is in our part when we talk about this. I think that is already totally removed. If you live in a way that you allow human beings to live in dignity, in justice, in peace, in freedom, you are good. And if you are not do that, don't claim any other thing. You are not, period. So I think it's a kind of clarification. When do you think I'm better than you and this and this? Or when, well, I am what I am. And it makes a lot of easy way of looking at things.
Yeah, he said, who am I to criticize?
Yeah, is it, yes.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Sharing that perspective. If you got an extra ticket,
yeah.
Take it off of Craigslist right now. Get in touch with us. We know someone who needs the hookup.
Who needs it?
Yeah, deserves it. Well, regatta comes from the Venetian language, meaning contention for mastery. In the strictest sense, a regatta is a series of boat races, typically rowed or sailed. But just imagine the quizzical looks those Venetian speakers would cast over Valentino Pier in Red Hook if they could witness 3D-printed remote control boats navigating the choppy waters of the Hudson. Well, BRIC TV producer Charlie Hoxie spent some days down on the docks, and he brought this back.
Everybody my age or like younger don't know a lot about the whole history of Red Hook, the whole importing, exporting, shipping, cargo. We thought it would be a great idea to put that on display.
For this event, we are learning ourselves and also teaching about the history of the neighborhood, but we're using 3D printers to do it by creating a boat race that's modeled on the shipping history of the neighborhood.
So we thought it would be cool to recreate kind of what the Dutch people did back in the day. So we just made boats, and we're going to simulate by having little bricks getting put down at the pier and keeping score.
The Red Hook Regatta is a collaboration between Pioneer Works and the Red Hook Initiative. and more specifically the digital stewards program within the Red Hook Initiative.
Yeah, man, I was gonna say, make sure that the bottom piece is like inside there.
The Red Hook Initiative has a program called the Digital Stewards, and they basically just train for people to become professionals in the technical world. We learn everything about computers. We learn the insides of it and the outside. We're doing the software. We learn all the parts that go into the computer. We learn how to do videos, basically everything with new technology. When I first came to this program, I had no idea what I was going to be doing. And then just out of nowhere, he asked, would you like to do an event about 3D printed boats? I'm like, I don't know. All right, I'll do it. It just became the best experience ever.
Having hands-on experience with 3D printing now is, I think it's great. You know, it opened up a whole new side of technology I didn't think that I knew or I could learn, you know, so you can build whatever you want, you can do whatever you want with 3D printing, so it's great.
Screw it up. I need to take that thing off, unfortunately.
Oh my god, what just happened?
Come on.
Up until the last couple weeks, before we had seen a fully assembled working boat, you know, I think in all of our minds, there was still the question of, is this going to work? We all started knowing the exact same amount about boats, which is zero, basically. So I think we've all learned so much about even just rudder design and propulsion and all that stuff.
Everybody else's designs is kind of big. You know, everybody, they're like real out there. So I didn't know it was going to be this small, but being that it's this small, it should take flight. But at the same time, it's either, you know, sink or float. I think it's going to sink. So I'm going to try my best and make it work.
And we both in the same spot. We both about to put our motors inside.
We know, like, there'll be some level of chaos. We don't know how much, but that's kind of what we're in it for. We're in it to try this thing that's never been done before and know we'll pretty much get it to happen, you know? I think, like, pretty much is a success.
Thanks for coming. Yeah. We'll expect the first seat in a few minutes. Somebody score, I can't see over there. The sun is in my eyes now, guys. I can't see.
Now we have a situation with our first place where John's boat scored 7 points, but is now not operational. Jesus' boat scored 6 points and is semi-operational. So what we're going to do after a long, hard decision is we are going to share first place of this competition between Jesus and John because we cannot say that either of these guys did not win this race.
It's freaking amazing. Like, everybody came outside, everybody came to see us do this little event. It was just awesome.
It was amazing. I didn't think everybody would show. I thought it was gonna be at least 30 people. It came out to at least 100, right? It's pretty cool, pretty cool.
I had an amazing time. We made a few mistakes. You know, everything that like kind of went wrong with today's event, we'll take it, go back to the lab, revamp it, and come back out next year for part two.
It was a tie. Sometimes it works out that way.
Yeah.
There are no losers when you're at a Red Hook Regatta, let me tell you that.
I had never seen 3D printing before, so that was really exciting. It's really like you're watching, like, it's Star Trek.
It's like a spider spinning a web. Somebody wants to something here.
Yes, but beautiful.
Good on you guys.
When people talk about school choice, they're usually referring to the debate over public charter schools, which is about getting more educational options. But some people might say they have too much choice. Those are the students and their parents who right about now are in the midst of applying to New York City high schools. To put it mildly, it's a confusing and frustrating process. The big citywide high school fair is happening this Saturday and Sunday at Brooklyn Tech High School. Last year, we followed one slightly overwhelmed eighth grader. Let's take a look.
I feel very, it's really annoying to me how some schools have certain tests to get into their schools, like Bard has a separate test than the SHSAT schools. And it's just really annoying because, like, it just takes up so much time and it's just jam-packed your schedule because you really want to get into a good high school, but you still have to do your homework for regular school, and it's just a lot of work to do. A lot of other people helped me prepare for this process. My band teacher helped me, and my parents really helped me prepare for this process. And my friends have always been there for, like, support and stuff, and we've all helped each other.
Please exit through the rear door.
It's been a lot more stressful to balance all these tours and stuff. I didn't really know that much about the high school process in 6th and 7th grade, but towards the middle of the school year, like in about February, January, I started to learn more about the process and what to do because the guidance counselor was really helpful in telling us what we needed to do to get into the high schools we wanted to get into. And I also started preparing my audition pieces for the arts-based high schools in January and February because they're very competitive and I really want to go to one. I found out how competitive the high schools were when we got the high school books from last year. It showed me, like, there's a lot of kids applying. There's 20,000 kids applying, like, each year. It's just very crazy and it's very hard to get a slot inside of LaGuardia or Frank Sinatra if you're an instrumental musician. So I really started preparing so I could land a slot in one of those schools.
The entire high school process, I think the most stressful part about it is that the time frame is very short. You basically have from September to, I want to say December, the applications are due, but you have the audition process, which is very stressful.
This higher school process is a very challenging. You know, it's really difficult to decide which school is good for my daughter, and the whole process is very complicated.
So this is our second child who's going through this. Our older daughter went through it about 2 years ago. And the thing that really struck me about it is that applying to public high school in the city of New York is like a complete black box process in the sense that, you know, you go to visit a bunch of schools and you create a list and then you apply to that list and you have no idea how any of those schools choose who their student body is going to be. So I would say, you know, a little bit of transparency. I mean, a little bit of transparency is never a bad thing in any situation.
What I liked about the high school fair was that the line moved very quickly. I got to meet people, other kids at specialized high schools and other schools I want to go to. And what I didn't like about the fair was all the flights of stairs I had to walk up. I had to walk up 7 flights of stairs. And then I also had to go to the third floor for Manhattan schools, which was super, super crowded, and there was, like, no AC, so it was really burning hot, and I was just, like, up next to everybody. It was just really stressful, and one of the schools I came to see, their beacon, wasn't there, so it felt like kind of a waste of time. But overall, it was a pretty good experience. I learned a few new things, and I was really happy I went.
For me, but I think I'm pretty well off because I was informed. But if you have a parent who hasn't been, I guess, in the know, it is very, very stressful. And I went to the high school fair, the All City, and I don't necessarily think it was that informative because there were a lot of students there, but not enough faculty from the school to give you the perspective from a parent's point. I think from the student's point, they were there, and that's good. But as the parent, I ultimately make the decisions, and the type of questions that I'm asking, I couldn't get answers to.
For that view, like Melody said, young folks will be doing this again this weekend, but we happen to know that that young man featured in the piece found his high school. He tested and auditioned into La Guardia.
Oh.
So he's at the forefront of creativity in New York City public schools.
That's right.
He's got a long way to go, that young man.
Yeah.
Good prospects for him.
In the West African tradition, griots are storytellers who maintain a tradition of oral history. Simply put, they're the keepers and disseminators of our collective consciousness. That tradition is alive and well here in Brooklyn, and the history is happening right now. Griots in the Sty, a neighborhood as a living archive, is described by its organizers as an ephemeral public art exhibition of photographs.
Those photos are being accompanied by an online archive of personal stories from Bed-Stuy residents. Independent curator Rasu Jelani conceived of Griot in the Sty and actually shot the video components of the show. Welcome to BK Live, Mr.
How you doing?
And
welcome back.
Welcome.
Oh, even. Yeah, thank you for having me.
Again. Wow.
The seat's still warm. Kwesi, you're from Guyana.
Yes,
and you've actually trained your lens on New York, shooting photos and experimental short films about the human state. And some of those photos are featured in Griot in the Sty. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for being here and inviting me.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Got some questions for these guys.
Yeah, I've got a few questions for you, if that's okay.
Go ahead, shoot.
But let's start from the beginning. Why don't you tell us about your backgrounds and what you guys do?
I'll defer to Ross. Oh, okay. He wants to defer to me. Okay. I'm Kwesi Abensetz. I'm originally from Guyana. I came to the United States in 95, and I lived in New York briefly for about a year. Then I moved to Maryland, D.C. area, moved back to New York in 2002, and I've been here since.
Didn't love the Maryland?
No, I actually did love it. I loved it because there was like a lot of trees and space and so forth, so it kind of since I just left Guyana, where it's more very open to, so I wanted that feeling again, so I went.
And you were a self-trained photographer, so what inspired you to pick up the lens and figure this thing out?
Well, I guess it's related to personality, because I went to Brooklyn College for filmmaking, but in terms of filmmaking, it requires such a large amount of people. So when I finished, I just got myself a camera and just wanted to kind of do things by myself, so I chose to, well, digital photography started happening at that time. And so I just went ahead and bought a digital camera and just started teaching myself, and then, you know, from there. I didn't really call myself a photographer then, though. I was just a guy with a camera.
So, Rasu, how'd you get mixed up with this guy with the camera?
I've known Kwesi for almost, probably like a decade.
Yeah.
And just always been an admirer of his work, his eye, his keen eye on, you know, representing people of the darker complexion in his photography. So when I was embarking, or I was coming up with this idea for, at the time it was just called the Bed-Stuy Portraits, I was thinking about, I personally wanted to capture stories, but I needed someone with a keen eye on capturing portraits. And the first person that came to mind was Kwesi. And we worked before in Jamaica, doing something similar in Jamaica, but I wanted to kind of get deeper in the process. So this project is really about process. It's really about honoring people's truths and stories and talking about a community from within, because media has really been taking a top-down approach of looking down and dissecting and analyzing a community. I wanted those stories to come from within the community.
So why Bed-Stuy?
We live there.
We've been making a lot of memories there. We have been, I mean, the people that we have featured, they have been they have been part of our lives for so long. And then it's just to bring everyone, again, as Rasu said, you know, bring everyone from the bottom up to the top, because it's just bringing everyone to the surface. And maybe it's from the perspective of just saying, like, well, not making it so localized in the sense of just local. What does that mean? It just means that we're giving recognition to the people. We're also bringing our, I should say, encouraging the confidence of even the people in the neighborhood.
Right.
And the other perspective is, you know, I wanted to tell a story about the cultural shift in New York City, and that's such a ambitious conversation to have. Yeah. So the best way to really enter a conversation is start from, you know, a microcosm. And so what I've been doing is looking at how can I tell a New York story but using my neighborhood and enrolling my neighborhood into that storytelling. So it's looking at my neighbors as collaborators in this mm-hmm. collective storytelling. And then so even within Bed-Stuy, which is huge, mm-hmm. I had to really focus on my corridor of Tompkins Avenue.
Right.
So Tompkins Avenue becomes the spine of the project, and I kind of have anecdotal kind of stories off of the corridor. So Tompkins Avenue becomes a metaphor for Bed-Stuy, Bed-Stuy becomes a metaphor for Brooklyn, Brooklyn becomes a metaphor for New York City.
Mm-hmm. I'm interested in what surprised both of you. If you, Rasu, in hearing some of the stories of the neighbors, the people we sort of pass every day, was there anything that sort of made you pause for a second and hearing the story behind just seeing the face on the street?
I would say the overarching, I guess, surprise. Because, mm-hmm. I mean, one of the things about this project is you go in, and because you're with the community, you already have these assumptions. I had to empty my cup,
right.
And it reset my assumptions about my community. Mm. So one of the overarching lessons that I've learned or breakthroughs I've had is the complexity of a neighborhood, you know? So, for example, if I pick up the Wall Street Journal or New York Times, they'll tell you Bed-Stuy is an up-and-coming neighborhood because of these reasons. And it's a very kind of outside mm-hmm. perspective. But however, when you get into the community, all of the minutiae and all the nuances of the community, you start to notice all of these parallel narratives, all of these complex stories. So a neighborhood is very complex. And what's happening in a neighborhood in terms of the change, there are complex reactions to it, there's mm-hmm. complex reasons to it, and there's complex involvement in it. So just having an overarching, you know, oh, people are just pushing people out, or about some of that is happening, that's a valid story, right. But there's other stories going on. So let's get into the complexities and not try to oversimplify right. and create
or
this.
Or sweep it under the rug,
under
right?
The rug. Yes,
you're trying to really
yep.
put that in focus, right? You're
absolutely.
Purposefully taking people who've been in the neighborhood for a long time and folks mm-hmm. who have just moved in mm-hmm. and bring them together.
There are two communities, and from our perspective, this is my perspective.
Only there's two? Mm-hmm.
There's two communities in Bed-Stuy. There's the new incoming community, right? And then there's the traditional community. Mm-hmm. And what I find is that, for the most part, mm-hmm. you know, there are exceptions. They don't talk to each other.
Right.
So you have these two communities, and the fault line is this assumptions about each other.
Right.
This project seeks, but it's not, you know, I can't be ambitious enough to know it's gonna
right.
be the answer.
Yeah.
It seeks to have people start to imagine, okay, what's the story behind my neighbor? Yeah.
So we are in our like last minute. Is the project closed? Is it gonna be ongoing? I know you've been working with the folks at Laundromat.
Project,
they've been
yeah.
a good project, Laundromat project. They've yeah. been a partner for you. So are you going to expand, or where can folks see it?
Okay, so the Laundromat project, they're the organization that has commissioned this project and
right.
sponsoring it. The project is not done. So there's mm-hmm. three phases, right? There's personal. Those are the stories that I've collected over the last 5 months.
Right.
There's public, which is the public exhibition, which we unveiled last Sunday. And then the last phase is digital, which I'm working on right now, is developing a website that's not done yet. It's not up yet,
right?
Right.
Right.
So
and
right,
the photos will be up through November?
The photo will
Did
be
I
up,
because right?
it's digital, the photos will be up forever, digitally.
But what right? about the ones that are on the,
wall, the
storefront?
Indefinitely, until the owner tells
until they, oh, that's great.
Yeah, so.
That's great.
So that, and then our next phase is, there's another local, a business that said, you know what, put some on my wall as well. So there's going to be another phase.
All right, I live in Bed-Stuy. Where can we go see it?
It's on Tompkins and Monroe.
Okay.
On the wall of a local boutique called Sincerely Tommy.
Okay.
Right on that wall, you'll see about 31 faces.
Yeah, right across from Crocus.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Excellent. All right, I'll be by to see him.
Yes, thank you.
Thank right. you for coming.
Thank you so much.
I'm excited about your
thank
project.
You so
on to
appreciate
phase three. Now to a stellar performance from F. Stokes on Brick TV's Stellar Live Music Show. Here he is singing Blessings.
Good good evening. Yes, my stomach growling be the reason. I'm out here with a season, scheming, running till I'm wheezing. Baby needs shoes and my nephews is teething. Mama keeps and she wishing upon a star. Somebody tell my brother I love him wherever you are. To him I was Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. But no, I left and I came back like a Martian. He thought I moved to Mars. No, dog, I moved to planet maturity. Daddy ain't no curing me. Used to cook coke and take what's left of his purity. Down to my nose bled. Selling rocks and true X was hollying with dope heads. All a brother wanted was a Chevy with some sounds. Told my cousin my dream and he fronted me that brown. Now I'm insane in my membrane. I'm my ex-girlfriend stuck on cocaine. I'm hurting, don't it show me? My tats show pain. Victim of how I live, blame it on the dope game. Until we meet again, roughly that second verse, I let that Vinny Toma beat carry like a hearse. So here goes another gem, for my brothers pimping with that Chevy off in a brim. And them gators on they socks, and candy on that caddy, we gon' let that beat knock. I say, as I stretch my frame across my auntie sofa, wake up and I'm confronted by this Jesus Christ poster that reads, a family that prays together stays together. And I think, man, we ain't never prayed before, but we all been homeless since, slept on Granny's flow together. And we all done so dope together. I look up to the sky and say,
now or never.
Look at us, Kanye kids and common offsprings. The money I spent on music and they bought bling. Four monkeys riding a Chevy with no AC. Only thing was missing is a new sweat, watermelon juice. And comb my hair with chicken bones. See, Felicia wanna weave and then marry a silicone. But you see, both of them wanted me, black and ashy as ever. Saw me live in BK and thought my wordplay was clever. Seen the album cover, thought the boat side was pimp. Then they met me in person, no less than a gent. Maybe a little overconfident, but that's a compliment. Cause if I don't love myself, who else gonna acknowledge it? We on tip strippers no more, I give out scholarships. F dots, those for the people yelling populist. Not to get it confused with these shorties buying new shoes and barely even got a pot to piss. But as I stretch my frame across my auntie's sofa, look up and I'm confronted by the Jesus Christ poster. A family that prays together stays together. And I think, man, we ain't never prayed before, but we all been homeless and slept on Granite's flow together. And we all done so dope together. I look up to the sky and say it's now or never.
Yo, all I do is dream about getting the cheddar though. Say Costco, why you wearing a sweater though? Keep it stupid, never scared of the better flow. Words from a hat like barely a metaphor. Still finding myself, the reason I metaphor. I'm such a boy, but I never be swined out. Still I'm popping like bacon and I ain't faking. I'm totally joking, Oakley, Dokley. But why you provoking me? Totally openly, you could just smoke with me. They know me in France for killing it locally. Murder it, drugged up, and trashed it soberly. Four leaf clover till it's over. Under the influence, I'm congruent with the truest. We the newest, sick like the flu is, but so contagious, so outrageous. Raising the bar up and turning the pages. Cos run rap, word to ASICs.
New York City, make some noise.
Yo! It's your boy.
These are our blessings. These are our blessings.
Bless.
These are our blessings.
Bless.
You guys represent our blessings.
Okay. Here at BK Live, there have been some changes. New table set up, a new call letters at Brick TV. But wow, there's lots of shiny newness. There is also the warm embrace of old familiar friends, namely our Sultans of Fun.
The most familiar, most friendly friends we know are Dick and Dave. And in addition to being the friendliest friends this show can have, they're also the most connected guys this side of the Brooklyn Bridge. Dick would be Richard Burrows of the Brooklyn Reader, sir.
Welcome.
And Dave, David Colon of Brooklyn.com, are here to kick off the fall and the weekend the right way with some tips and sips. The tips are courtesy of them, and the sips were courtesy of Trent Welsh, the mixologist at the Drink Lounge in Crown Heights.
Mm-hmm.
So happy fall to you guys. We're one day in, right? One day into autumn.
Not okay with it.
One day in.
No.
It's fine.
And at least also, it's 80-something degrees.
Bring back summer.
I saw
we're also in the midst of, the Pope Mania.
Popeganda.
Although I have raised the snaffle to the papal visit to the begavel, but he is making a lot of problems.
traveling.
Well, you should probably just
don't go to Manhattan.
Yeah, right. Just find yourself at the drink. Park yourself at a bar stool and
exactly
let it wash over you.
Let me get some pour in a glass.
Right. We're located in Brooklyn off Franklin Avenue, so we're far from any of the Manhattan madness of the Pope.
And Franklin is really cracking nowadays.
Yes.
They've got everything on
everything.
So where should we be going first of all, sir?
First of all, it's a bunch of things. I can probably start on a Saturday with Brooklyn Comes Alive, which is a pretty awesome sort of, almost like a
Day
to Dawn festival. It goes so long. If you could do the whole festival, like you have some level of inner 5-hour energy that most people don't have. 15 hours, a long time, bro.
Oh, that's it?
Easy.
Pharmaceutical.
That's easy. It's easy. Yeah. You'll be taking a nap. But it's all over. It's actually at Verboten Cabaret, and also at Williamsburg Hall of Music. Some of the bands that I'm looking forward to is Billy Martin.
Yeah.
Not the old Yankee, but the guy from Adiski, Martin and Woods.
Yeah.
And it's also Doug Wimbish from Living Color, which should be really dope. And also Mark Brownstein, I'm looking forward from Disco Biscuits.
Disco Biscuits.
I like my biscuits very disco.
Are they still together?
With a drink.
I don't know. I think maybe that could be his first
solo.
Yeah.
I've got like hippie friends who I think still go to Camp Bisco. I think I saw some Facebook post about, you know,
excellent,
great time there or something.
Right.
I don't know. So I guess they're still around.
But that should be dope. It's like it's like 30 bands. It's like it's a music extravaganza. It's on Saturday. And it's mainly in Williamsburg. And if you get over that side of town, you can, you know, buy a pass and
go to all the
go to everything. And it's also one DJ I know of for sure that's going to be like only DJing is DJ Logic.
Well, Trent is getting real free with that bullet over there.
What's going on over here, Trent?
Trying to make them all at once, man.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Whoa.
Efficiency is key.
No.
That would put you under.
A bullet to the head.
That would pharmaceuticals. So, Dave, okay, once we've gotten our nap after that 15-hour dance-a-thon,
and
what
after
can
this
you do?
Drink, apparently.
Go to the Atlantic Attic.
Atlantic Attic.
Which is, it's family friendly, but you can drink in the street too. Which
perfect.
Is,
it's
yeah,
here.
Convenient. It's, you know, if you haven't been to the Atlantic Attic, you should go. It's just all of Atlantic Avenue from the water all the way down to like Flatbush Avenue is just closed off to traffic. Mm-hmm. Wander around in the street. Don't worry about getting hit by any cars.
Nice.
People got booths all along outside. All the businesses have, you know, like little tables, a lot of street food.
Yeah, there's music.
You guys have
tons
something,
of music.
Right?
We've Brick's got a B-side happening there.
Oh, nice.
There go, yeah.
That should be pretty cool.
Be performing at that.
Billy's favorite, Aki Burmese, is going to be on the Brick B-side.
Yeah, check that
there
out.
There you go. I'll be there. So.
How many years is that going now?
41.
A million. 41. Wow, that's pretty dope.
So if you like the show, buy me a drink.
Excellent.
And if you don't like the show,
buy you a drink.
Pretend you don't see me.
Buy you a drink anyway.
Speaking of drinks, Trent, what is happening over here?
This would be one of our signatures. This is the Brown Derby.
Oh my.
It's got bullet bourbon, grapefruit, lime juice, and agave. With a little smacking of mint, that was where I hit the mint just a moment ago. Mm-hmm. It brings out the flavor, right, but not too much. It's not like I muddled it, so you're not really getting a mojito flavor out of this. You're getting more of a reference of mint.
You mixologists get off on smacking that mint, don't you?
I'm about the part of the show, man. I like it.
You guys are smack mint.
Holy. Salud.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Next summer.
Don't fight it, Dave.
Don't fight the feeling.
I gotta wear t-shirts again. I can't wear jerseys.
Is there another drink coming? Or?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, that's gonna be our signature, the drink. It's purple in color and delicious in flavor.
Nice.
Well, let's let this marinate for a while. And when you tell us about Drink Lounge, you said it's on Franklin and what?
Franklin and St. John's, 768 Franklin Avenue. We've been open for about 3 months now. But it's, we're new kids on the block.
All right.
I'm even new to this town. I've only been here since July. But
I
came in with quite a bit of bar experience. So.
Right, you parachuted into a job.
Sort of, yeah.
Well, if you keep doing them like
the sort of thing you hear about, you know?
Yes, yeah.
At least.
And cheers to Chardon.
Shadon, yes, thank you very much. Yeah, he's one of our owners. He's absolutely been wonderful. He's got the aesthetic and the style for the place. Mm-hmm. He's the energy behind it, and mm-hmm. he's been just pushing us forward. And it's been a wonderful experience.
Yes. So is it like a date night place? Is it grown and sexy? Is it coming?
It is. We have velvet wallpaper, nice hardwood. We have a nice little area up in the front. We have chandeliers. We also have a back patio area that's set up sort of like a spa.
It's dope.
Yeah.
Wow. A spa?
Like a spa feel. It's not an actual spa. We have no steam anywhere, unfortunately.
Okay, no hot tubs.
No hot tubs. Right.
Maybe
in the next
So are you all hot tubbing this weekend? What's your second choice?
Well, I might burn my face by going to the Chili Pepper Festival at the...
At the Botanic?
Botanic, yeah. That's pretty cool. That's 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. on Saturday. And it's a bunch, like it says, 5 blazing bands,
yeah, what's
2 legendary fire breathers, 7 hours of chocolate debauchery, 52 fire... It's a lot of stuff going on. It's at the Cherry Esplanade.
Yeah.
In the Botanical Gardens. But
feel
for the most part...
You can get started.
You can go there and get your face... Get your taste buds
burnt
on fire,
all numb,
and you have to really know your limit when it comes to chili peppers, because you can't
early.
Play yourself
really?
And then just want to pass out, yeah. You know, because passing out in public is only good for pregnant women and like babies.
And then not even.
Is it, yeah, right. Good
that's
for
pretty
them
scary, I say.
When a pregnant woman passes out.
Well,
look. You get all the good seats on the summer.
Yeah.
Maybe just more understandable is what he meant. Maybe it just
understandable.
Makes more sense.
Understandable.
Yeah.
Bomb.
Yeah.
That's
bomb.
Why they get all the good seats on the subway. Bomb. They're always passing out willy nilly.
I know.
Watch out below.
You
have the gardens as well.
It's good for them, so.
It's good.
Doctor's orders.
And if you pass out at the garden, it's like so many soft places to land.
Lush.
You might pass out and then just stay there.
Land right on a block.
Okay, please revive this pregnant woman with something good to do.
We got a Bitches Brew. It's a comedy at Halyards out in Gowanus. And it's I've been to this show. It's a good show. The hosts are extremely funny, and this one is going to be. They always have a musical guest, mm-hmm. and this time they have these guys in North Coast. They're a hip hop improv comedy group.
Mm. Oh,
which I feel like is. They, you know, there's already a thing in hip hop. It's improv. It's called freestyling. So I don't quite get what
you know. It's going to
right,
be like
why they're not like you know why they're. What's gonna be?
Remember the show Lyricist Lounge?
Yes,
vaguely, yeah.
On TV,
mm-hmm.
when it had Tracy Ellie Ross on it from Blackish.
Yeah.
And the Lyricist Lounge guys.
Yeah.
You know, so
who
I think it's gonna be more. It's gonna
that?
Be kind of like that. I think.
Where is it again? Where is it?
Oh, it's at Halyards.
Bitches Brew.
Yeah, Bitches Brew is at Halyards. I mean, I'm sure it'll be funny. They book good people. You know, I said, hip hop improv. Group that sounds just like a bunch of freestylers who know jokes,
right?
Which is not a bad thing.
No,
I didn't mean to make it sound like that, but and also it's free, so it's not like you go and if it's bad, you know, you go, I want my money back. You know, the worst you've done is bought like a cheapish beer, and you know, they have good beer selection at Halyards.
Nice,
I feel like maybe I'm kind of underselling this one.
That sounds really good. Sounds good. What else is there?
There's the Center for Arts and Culture,
The Center for Arts and Culture, which sounds really kind of like highfalutin.
Mm.
Like, oh my god,
mm-hmm.
But it's at
Bedford Pierce.
Restoration Corp, yeah. And Wendell Pierce is going to be there, it's going to be a literary brunch. So you can listen to Wendell talk about his new book, The Wind in the Reed, The Wind in the Weeds, The Wind in Weeds, all about New Orleans, because you know he's from New Orleans, his family's from New Orleans, and he speaks a lot about how New Orleans is still sort of in a bounce back mode from Katrina.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that just being in New York, we kind of like don't really fully grasp how devastating it was and how devastating it how the place is still, because our national tragedy was 9/11, and everyone always says, you know, never don't forget or always, what is it?
Hashtag never forget.
Never forget.
Bad.
Right.
You forgot.
But that is and it's hosted by the guy what is his name, Terrence McKnight from WQXR. So that should be really good. That's on Sunday's brunch situation.
All right. Well, you've got 35 seconds to sell us on this.
A hip hop dance party.
Old
it's a hip hop dance party. What else could
Say
you do?
No
it's
more.
A hip hop dance party. It's a friends and lovers. It'll be great. Everybody loves hip hop music.
Friends and
Can
lovers.
Can we mention
not
the other thing real quick?
You
yes. Right. Other right. Thing.
Friends and
Next
lovers.
Thing.
Crowd Heights. And then you've got. Late Night Basement. Late Night Basement is so fun. It is a talk show. It's in. They moved to live stream public. It used to be in the back of a bar. But I'm sorry. I'm running right over your.
Waves, brunch, dinner, dancing, SEC football. That's good. It's on Saturday.
Where's that?
It's at Freehold at 45 South 3rd Street in the Williamsburg section of Brooklyn.
Okay, what are we drinking, Trent? No.
This is our new signature. It is the drink.
The drink.
It is, as you can see, purple in it's essence, purple. Much like our wallpaper. When you go in there, you'll find velvet. Purple
Perfect.
Wallpaper.
Right. I love to match my drinks to my wallpaper.
It's very important to do that.
Cheers again. Double cheers.
Double cheers. Like, these are scary glasses.
I asked them to put this in a rocks glass because I'm 12 years old and I probably shouldn't.
Well, this was a great pour for this. I mean, you didn't do it to the top where it's scary.
Yeah, no. And these are slightly oversized, too. We like to do that so there's a little bit of space so you can properly drink it. You don't want to have it all the way up to the edge.
But the third one is
when you're paying for it, you want it up
to the top. It tastes like sweet tarts.
No,
it tastes like sweet tarts. The bitter truth is a violet liqueur. It's made of distilled violets.
Violet, that's what I'm tasting.
Like the candies. I like those candies.
Yes.
Exactly.
Those are amazing. They are, but they're wonderful.
Violet candies.
My grandmother did have those in her
Catholic
bag.
Catholic ladies in church.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
So once again, it's Drink Lounge.
Yes.
Which is where again? Where everyone should go?
It is 768 Franklin Avenue on by St. John's in Crown Heights.
Right.
Perfect. Awesome.
Right. Yeah. Yes.
And we're out. Get in there, Melody.
All right. Thank you guys for being here.
Thank you very much.
All right. Make sure to find yourself back here on Monday when New York City Comptroller Scott Stringer comes by to detail his report on the state of unbanked New Yorkers. Mm. Now, if you have some money in the bank just waiting to be put to work, you may want to consider starting a flea market. My co-host here learned a lot about that when he went to Williamsburg and caught up with the co-founders of Artist and Fleas.
It's true. It was quite an education. And tomorrow will be televised host Simon Applebaum. Is a quick study, and he'll be here with a first glance at the winners and losers of the fledgling fall TV season. And speaking of new seasons, you can check ours out, new or old, actually. It's all there on the YouTubes at Brick TV. Thanks for joining
us,
guys.
Thanks for joining us. Cheers.
Cheers.